Thank you very, very much. And please give a very big applause to Marie for organizing this with Jessica and her amazing team. And of course, many, many thanks to Mark Spiegel also. It's really in conversations with Mark that we, and with Marie, that the three of us discussed after the many years of the Artist As panel, where we explored, you know, all kinds of different roles and parallel realities of artists, from the artist as an anthropologist, to the artist as an activist, to the artist as a composer, that we felt it would be time to kind of start a new long-term panel. The great thing about Art Basel is that one of the many great things about these panels is that they can evolve, that it's something which can, over many years, be a kind of a learning system. And so we are very, very excited today to start this new panel. We thought it would be interesting to actually think about artists, because ever since I started to be with art and to visit artists, one of my first studio visits was Fischli Weiss, when after seeing their exhibition actually here in Basel, which Jean-Christophe Amann had organized. It was the first big show of Peter Fischli and David Weiss at the Kunsthalle Basel here in 1985. It's the first time the equilibrium photographs were exhibited. And I was then 17 years old, and this exhibition was completely life-changing for me. And the next day, after having seen it, I showed up in the studio of Peter Fischli and David Weiss, you know, as a teenager, and just, you know, wanted to meet them. And it was this incredible moment when they made The Way Things Go, Lauf der Dinge, in the studio. And towards the end of the visit, they said, you know, I said I was cool, we'll go on a school trip to Rome. And they said, you should really visit Alighiero Boetti. He's such an inspiration on them and on many other artists. And they gave me the telephone number. And that was really the beginning of, you know, the practice, in a way, of this methodology where I would always visit or meet artists would tell me about. And I think this whole idea of artists is an urgent thing. And it went on, actually, until most recently when I visited Daniel Monaghan's exhibition here in Basel, in at Weiss-Falk, and there was an homage to Damon Zucconi, who is a great inspiration on Daniel. So generation after generation, you know, that idea of artists continues. So we're unbelievably excited today to start this new panel, and very, very delighted to welcome JODI, John Henskerk and Dirk Pesmans, Jamie and Juliano-Villani, Brian Belott and Damon Zucconi. Please give them a very, very warm welcome. Now, the rule of the game of the panel is that we invited, actually, Damon and also Jamian to suggest who are their artists, who are artists they are inspired by. And Damon wanted to talk to JODI, who have inspired him for many, many years. And Jamian wanted to invite Brian. So I thought maybe we could somehow, before we then all have a bigger jam session and have also your questions, structure it in terms of two separate conversations, and maybe have first of all a conversation with Damon and JODI, and then a conversation with Jamian and Brian. So Damon, maybe to begin with the beginning, can you tell us a little bit what prompted you to want to meet here JODI, and what inspires you about their practice?
Sure. So, I mean, I encountered JODI's work very early on in my life before I really, like, thought of myself as an artist as such. I was just somebody that made websites. And I think when I was about, like, 15 or 16, I encountered JODI's work. And that was kind of the moment in which I realized that you could have sort of a primary aesthetic experience online. It's not just, like, documentation of work or anything like that. It's something like this kind of pure aesthetic experience. This just came up, but this is funny. I just wanted to show this one image because I made this about a decade ago, which I'm not that old, so it's weird to say that. But this was, just to say what it is, I had a 3D scan of my head made. And in the background is some screenshots of JODI websites. And so I was pretty young, and this is maybe like dealing with like the anxiety of influence or something. But it was too perfect of a thing to not show. It's all been leading up to this.
So we were inside your head.
Yeah, basically. Yeah, yeah.
That's the the purpose of our work and of artists in general to be inside someone's head. Yeah, the web was a perfect tool for that.
Yeah,
yeah. But we achieved.
But it's interesting, like by virtue of making this, like I somehow, like I guess you saw it, and you.
Yeah,
like
but I think you made it. I don't know when you made it, but it was a 3D animation. Yeah, some years later. I mean, after the original websites, I guess.
Right.
Kept like running around in your brain, and it came out as a 3D model. Cool.
Also, it's kind of interesting when we met them in New York. We talked about kind of processes of deconstruction, and you, for example, doing this amazing series of books where you kind of undermine, you know, programs of legibility and make these very different kind of books out of well-known existing books. So I wanted to ask you to tell us a little bit about this idea of, you know, actually ask all the three of you about deconstruction, because in each of your works there is a kind of a process of deconstruction and reconstruction. We spoke about that with Ben Vickers, our digital curator at the Serpentine earlier this week, and we somehow felt that, you know, the very kind of continual influence of evolving forms of media and communication has obviously consistently been a concern of artists over the past century. And it's kind of interesting thinking about that in Switzerland, where we celebrate at the very moment the centenary of Dada, no? Because that's obviously something which is at the core of a movement like Dada. So it's kind of curious that artists often working in the digital are kind of misunderstood as being medium specific, that it's kind of related only to the digital, no? Rather than working with universal threats. So I was kind of wondering, related to this, if you could talk a little bit about connections in terms of your art making to such historic movements like Dada, and also the way you kind of use deconstruction. Sorry for the long question.
So I guess just the books you're talking about, each individual word has like errors introduced into it, spelling errors, so that the entire book can be republished as like a new unique form. I think it's like when you start introducing errors into things, you start to see the sort of limits and boundaries of what that thing really is, which is sort of what I was trying to do. And I was thinking a lot about, you know, Jody's work. When things start to break down, you could start to see outside of them. I don't know.
For us it was a simple, practical, material curiosity, because we decided to start using the web before there was that was 95, 94, 95, so what was that thing? I mean, we didn't know what it was. What was a browser? What is the WW? What is, who is there also? So we, materially experimenting with it was a normal thing to do, because no one else would have told us anything about it, really. So it was like practical research or whatever. Also the feeling that, of course, that it was going to be a really important medium for the future. Like, I had been studying video and doing TV stuff when I studied with Nam June Paik, and Joan did photography. And those were two media of the 20th century, which came to an end at the end of 20th century. And we saw something appearing there out of an isolated computer, out of which was more a network, which it developed from the 80s out of bulletin board systems, which were limited connected computers, so a set of, in a city of a few hundreds or so. But at the moment there was the web, which was a global connection. So, and in our vision that we had as artists before, we wanted, well, we were dealing with mass media, photography into publishing, video into television, but there was no further access anymore. I mean, the artist would have no TV channel, even if Nam June Paik would have liked that. And I would wished he had could do more with the web, for example, but it's a logical continuation from global village, global groove to the web. And I saw that connection, and I think we both saw that, that the distribution power of the internet was more important than the material side of our individual artworks and being stuck into a gallery system. And we didn't want some, let's say, like photography or so. I mean, we wanted to get the magazine. We wanted to publish the magazine. So we wanted to publish, to make the website in that new medium. And we, yeah, it worked in a way that it, that our first friends were from Australia, Russia, Slovenia. They came from all over the place. So it was a global, it was immediately, a global, I mean, a mass medium, let's say. And we wanted to get involved in it, so.
I think you talk about destruction and construction. I mean, it's kind of funny that the digital indeed is material. As it's getting more accepted now to more on the surface. I mean, in 20 years ago, computer still is, even today, is, it doesn't function without code. So you have to, it's not only like deconstructive. I mean, deconstructive is just tearing it apart. Mm-hmm. But once you deconstruct it, you have to construct it again to get it stabilized somehow.
Yeah, I think what, that we also immediately noticed that of course, digital had the material side and that's code, and we never trained as coders. I was a sculptor and video maker and pushed buttons and everything, and the image rolls into the camera and into the synthesizer. But basically on a computer, nothing really interesting happens when you just use filters in Photoshop and, use an editor or pre-made templates. So we wanted at least to deal with the style and make that style ourselves. So the code, we needed to code, and Joan did a lot of work on coding the first websites and all the other projects we did later. And that's the, and then there also happened, of course, mistakes and so on, errors. And the errors were, we kept errors inside. Call that deconstruction or destruction, or it appeared, it all happened in a practical, by doing. I mean, the explanation of the first splash page of the website, I mean, that it's really a basic error in HTML, and then it happened during we were working on it, and we decided to keep it, and then we were afraid of it because it looked like the browser or the computer was damaged, because the surface of it looks damaged, or at least not formatted in the right way. And then we were thinking, should we now broadcast this error? Should we now, publish this mistake? Is this, can you do that? Like, you give someone a magazine, but it's in two parts. It's destroyed. You have teared it apart. Like someone has been jumping and on it, and it's dirty. Is this still a magazine or a print? And we decided to. So it was all practical,
But in other arts, if you make a collage and you rip things apart and put them together, nobody is somehow surprised that you do that. It's kind of a normal thing that you don't leave things intact. But for a lot of people, like digital is somehow sacred and you shouldn't touch it. And even if you touch it, you should do it in make a collage in Photoshop and not a collage in the real digital
code.
Material.
You made collages in code, basically, like improvising, learning bits and pieces.
Just copy and paste. I'm not a coder, I'm just copying and pasting and just putting things together. And I think with a art background, that's a normal way to approach things. And
you're artists, you don't know much.
I mean, when people encounter this stuff online, it's kind of often like detached from like the normative arts context where like you know how to read like a collage, like when it's on a wall. And it seems like it, more often than not, like you, there's like a sort of general public that encounters your work and is kind of baffled or doesn't really know what it is and doesn't really bring to it in like an arts context, and like that's really exciting in
that's
some ways.
Basically, but, like, the definition of mass medium. You know?
Right.
So that's we liked about mm-hmm. it. That was the we were seduced.
And how important was it or is it in this kind of in this whole work, this idea actually of you doing the programming? Because when it was kind of interesting, Damon, when we spoke in our first meeting, you told me about this 2013 program you wrote, Corrasible, how do you say it in English?
Corrasible,
which is a freely available API to actually transform text into these phonetic streams. And obviously something you use then a lot for your own work, but you're actually involved in the programming. So I was kind of wondering, because there's a lot of discussion going out right now about actually outsourcing, you know, that work to software engineers. So I was kind of wondering for the three of you how important it actually is, the role of programming and coding and infrastructure.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's super, super important. I've only become a programmer in maybe like the last 5 years. Like there was a decision like where like I needed more like agency in my studio practice, and it was like I either go to grad school or I learn how to program. That was the kind of the two doors for me. And I learned how to program. And what I didn't realize is how much of a tool for thought it is. One from the outside, you kind of imagine like you have this idea and then like that idea is fully formed and you start to program it and then it's done. But in reality, it's like a tool for like really expressing yourself and like through its materiality, like pushing it around, pulling it around, you start to see how to make the thing that you want to make. And it's much more fluid than I realized. So it's like super important to know how to program for me now.
I actually envy artists who outsource everything, and I really do.
Why?
Because I cannot help you on this. I'm absolutely not a programmer. So.
But yeah, I tried it a couple of times, and then it doesn't work out, and in the end I'm making it myself, because I think that the fact that is that if you outsource your IDs, you get like a prepackaged artwork you get back. And if you want to experiment, you can't outsource experiments because you don't know on forehand what's going to happen.
Yeah, what's going to happen, yeah.
It's also, if you outsource, you have to be like, I think
become
you have to express
a boring conceptual artist who exactly gets what he asks for.
and then your ID will be executed.
Right. It's not about IDs only. I mean, coding, you don't go from A to B directly. You're on the way, and on the way you encounter things, and then you decide, well, this is another direction I want to go, and that's what I see, Joan, and between us happening. That's what happened all the time, and you can't, the things we thought of, oh, this must be that, and then it must be coded and done, and it's only that kind of first idea we had in the beginning, and then it's usually not, the most interesting.
You make
word.
A mistake,
But about coding or code layers or the about the web and the early web, is that the code and making a web page were both embedded in the browser. The philosophy of the web and the inventors of the web was to create HTML. HTML as a code language, as to write your own simply in a very simple code, ABC type, 5 basic commands, and you can make things appear. You can make fonts bigger, you can go left, right, you color. So the code and do it yourself is a big, I mean, it's part of this that you can adapt the surface or the web or screen of the internet, if you want, onto your own as your own wish, you know. Now that's what now happens is that you're stuck in all kinds of formats. You're stuck in the Twitter design, you're stuck in the Instagram design, you're stuck in the grids they offer you. That's another web. I mean, if it's still web, that's what they call splinter net, you know, that it's not the unifying net where everyone has has access to and can adapt it, you know. So you're stuck in those templates now.
And anybody can view source, and so that,
yeah. Well, that became more difficult. Also, it was really easy to do that. The button of view source was more or less on top of the browser, and then you learned how to do that. And that was the idea. The let's do this together, and you just copy, and you don't have to learn to code. You just try it out, and then you see what happens. And that button has long disappeared. It's not there anymore.
Talking about communities, now you have open source and Git resources, which then basically everything was closed. So on the one hand, it has disappeared on the web, and everyone is hiding into trackers and cookies. But And you have this great community of people who want to share things together, like the open source movement. So it goes to both sides. There's kind of polarization, I think, happening.
But this idea of being stuck in these, you know, formats is kind of interesting, because in a way, obviously, exhibition is often about inventing new formats and, you know, not being stuck. So I was kind of wondering what to do, or if you can talk a little bit in the three of your practices, how to kind of get beyond this idea of being stuck and kind of rupture these stuck systems. Because obviously Billy Grant, who, as Marie said, is our guest of honor here today, and, you know, Collective Raindrop, who always says it is what it is, he talks a lot about glitches. And he says, you know, in order to get out of this idea of being stuck, you know, we need to use glitches. And that's something which the three of you do very strongly in your practice. You work with glitches, and we are thinking, for example, about the Google Maps. I was looking this morning, Damon, at your work with Google Maps, and then Jody, also you did works with Google Maps. So I was kind of interested how to subvert or disrupt these tools through glitches.
A glitch on demand is God, basically. Just found out. You cannot order that. It's not, it just, you know, appears.
Right.
And if you, it becomes, if you try to go for that, it's kitsch. You know, you make a mistake, and then you have to, or you're working and you have to decide, I'm going in that direction, or I made a mistake and maybe that's more interesting. Artists do that all the time. I mean, painters do that, yeah. Photographers do that, sculptors do that. But everyone, so in code, you can do that too.
Right, I mean, that maps piece that I made, which is, it's Google Maps, but all of the land masses are removed, and so it's just text. That was a complete accident where I was like exploring the Google Maps API, and I just turned off all the layers and was just blown away by how beautiful it was. That was it, that was the piece, done.
Could not have outsourced that.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's interesting, it's the outsourcing conversation. It's of course something which is discussed a lot in the context of post-internet art. A very, very warm welcome to Annie Perlman.
Yeah.
So yeah, in post-internet art, and that of course also leads us to Alexander Galloway's essay, which has just been published on eFlux. For those of you who haven't read it, I recommend it vividly as kind of parallel reading, you know, to the panel here today. And it's titled JODI's Infrastructure. And Alexander opens kind of with a whole series of questions, which I think could also be interesting for here today. And I was kind of wondering to hear a little bit the three of you talk about Galloway's opening questions. Should art orient itself towards the digital, or shall art merely live inside the digital while concerning itself with other topics entirely?
Yeah, I think you have to do both. You cannot live outside the digital anymore. And so, but you should not just accept it, which no one does, basically. Everyone hates Facebook and so on. But what can we do else, you know? It's like the boxes are full of Coca-Cola and there's no other choice. Pepsi, okay. So what would be what would be an alternative? Yeah, I don't know. Or do interventions in it. Don't take it too serious. Don't. What I find actually the most annoying, besides the template and how ugly it looks, is basically the terminology. I mean that it started to use words like follower, like friend. I mean it's a stupid cliche critique, but it gets confusing. I mean it gets used all the time and. Yeah, it kind of eats on society or for it will go into the it's just that would be the first terms I would eliminate in an alternative system of communication. Like if people would make and there are alternative Twitters like online off the grid, like make smaller communities which have the same possibilities as Twittering or Instagram and sharing photos, but do it without the outside of the big company. Let's put it outside of Big Brother's eyes, and for a certain necessity. There are people who have been doing that for a long time. NetTime mailing list as a mailing list, sending people. You can subscribe. You have the archive online, and so.
It's kind of how we met actually first. That's with Gerd Loring in the 90s.
Yeah, NetTime in the history of. Art online and so has a big function, I mean, at least in Europe. And they brought people together, they brought ideas together, and eventually some artists who expressed or made work. So, but yeah, making small, it's a bit back to the BBSs, you know, like the bulletin board systems, but in a more, but using the online, not the phone system in a primitive way, but using the web again for it. So that's become part of a EBS. You know, like you know, I for example, we don't have a Facebook. I don't know why exactly, but you know, or the other thing what is really annoying is that it's all self-promotion. So that's even worse than, That it's all about, all the curators are there, all the young old artists are there, and then they try to show their latest pictures, and they think, oh, wow, you've been there. Oh, wow, that looks like a cool exhibit. Oh, wow, it's all beautiful side of things. It's one big lie. A long set of strange, you know.
All the interesting communities, or at least the communities that I've been part of, are always... sort of piggybacked on getting real work done or something. Like there was a group of us using Delicious, which you sort of interjected into at one point with our performance. I don't know if you would call it.
Vaguely remember,
Winning information.
Delicious is long dead. So
I know.
That's all these services who appear sometime and then they disappear again.
But
that's what we would hope. That's what should happen. They should be there for 3-4 years and then die. go away. Yeah. Being replaced with something worse, of course.
Then that's obviously what Cedric Price said, you know, when he talked about the limited lifespan of the Fun Palace. He imagined a cultural institution having a limited lifespan, or an invention having a limited lifespan, even a book having a limited lifespan. But I was kind of wondering, because obviously in the 90s, you know, the notion of net art, you know, when I was introduced actually to the internet by Gerd Loving, sort of...
That's the best introduction.
Yeah, it was wonderful. And he basically was the one who in the early 90s prompted me to open my first CompuServe email address and so on, and the first one who told me about your pioneering work. And obviously at that time, there was NetTime, and through NetTime there was a lot of conversation about net art. And today we have the term of post-internet. So there is net.
You caught.
There is net art and there is post-internet. And so I was kind of wondering how the three of you relate to these terms now.
I mean, I don't even really think about it. Like, you know, I mean, I was also trained as a sculptor. But, you know, like, I'm sort of young enough that where, like, the internet was just always part of my life. And so, like, this, like, the works I make don't have this, like, this medium-specific distinction. And I try to flee those labels as much as possible, flee from.
Yeah, we saw the net as a really specific medium to use. Yeah, a German asks me to shut up.
Yeah, otherwise I don't get a chance. You know. No, I think all these terms are actually they come at a certain point. The main keynotes, while already the work has been done. I mean, the term net art was invented somewhere in 98. I mean, it started in 94, and I think it's the same with all the other terms. It's for art historians and curators to justify movements and put artworks into ghettos, and probably some fit in, some don't fit in. Artist, and I believe just in good and bad work, and I really don't believe in all these terms, and it makes me just I have to puke from it actually. It's always
Joan,
the work is
I'll take
gone.
The word again because this is kind of you're not at home here, have it on YouTube, okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of fascinating because in a way I was also wondering, you know, net art. I remember in my very first conversations with Gerd Loving at the time, you know, he told me a lot about this idea of revealing. I mean, I kind of was reading Italo Calvino at the time about the invisible city, and Gerd told me about this invisible kind of internet and exposing the net sort of beyond its shiny surface being important. Now, obviously, since then, many, many things have happened, and there are all kinds of technological transformation. But there have also been very transformative events which have actually revealed a vast apparatus of, you know, spying, surveillance. You know, the whole Snowden moment, of course, has happened. So I was kind of wondering how these, you know, really world-altering revelations affect or change your practice.
I mean, they just make you paranoid. I mean, it's funny because, like, I've always gotten a great deal of use out of analytics from my perspective, from my, like, God's eye view, where, like, you'll make a piece and you'll sort of, like, learn how it disseminates and learn and track it and sort of, and so therefore, like, how it's received, learn how to read it. And so, like, that's kind of, like, the positive, my positive perspective on it from my, like, power. And it's, I don't know how to respond to it though from like the outside. It's that these structures of power are just too, you feel helpless.
Yeah, it's a bit, yeah, it's also a cliche, but it's Big Brother, you know, 1984. I mean, that's what has.
Yeah, we knew it all the time.
Yeah,
it's
we
not
were
a surprise.
Warned by net time, warned by net art.
It's just on paper
art,
now.
You know?
I mean.
But yeah, it's a 1984 situation. Yeah, so that's why. I mean, just a few questions.
That's why
before
we don't have a Facebook.
Yeah. Starts with that, you know. No, but you saw that coming. I mean, once you have a.
Well,
it's like TV. I mean, we called our parents couch potatoes. Like, you know, and TV is watching you was also at the end a big slogan because TV and advertising were so close together. They were measuring what they could advertise, where they could advertise, who was looking at programs, and that was television. That was only television, and we were scared as hell, you know, like Big Brother. And now it's the internet in our pocket. Now that we do that, we carry that, as we say, we help them from our pocket on. We are, I mean, we're filling the statistics. Yeah, but okay.
Kind of.
Yeah.
You said you're not on Facebook.
Everyone knows that.
But you said you're kind of not on Facebook. I was wondering, the three of you, what kind of social media you use? Are you on Facebook?
I am, but I also like had a big hand in building a online platform.
Yeah, can you? I wanted to ask you about that actually. Yeah, can you tell us about your own platform?
You know, I mean, I think it's important for like if you need a community, then you have to go out and build it. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, that's what we did, and it's a sort of network that's based around research and making things, and a pretty active community of a couple thousand people. Don't know what else
and
to
how
say
does that. It work, this community? Can you tell us?
Sure. I mean, it actually takes a lot.
How can we join it?
ARE.NA. There. You know, it takes a lot from sort of Delicious, this like the activity of saving material and moving it around and seeing what other people are moving around and finding like kind of affinities between people and concepts.
And what about you? Explain. What social media are you using?
We don't use.
I just don't like to be social.
We did interventions. We made works in Twitter and YouTube, but we and some in Facebook. But you don't use them in a practical way. We don't live in a big city.
Do you still?
We see our friends just around the corner.
Are you still active on mailing lists, though?
Oh, yeah. We send email. But yeah, you are giving, I mean, Arena, the platform you worked on, that's exactly an example of that. Like off the grid, but online, you made your own community site, I mean, platform. And that platform work, yeah, that even if it won't work, it's still conceptually the thing you can do. And then you give at least an example. If people ask you, so what do you do against Big Brother? Well, we made our that tool, that platform. And
I've got a last question I wanted to ask you, which is, it kind of ties in with conversations Damon, you and I had in New York, but it ties in actually also with conversations we had with John and Dirk almost 20 years ago in Kassel, where we met actually for the first time in person after having met indirectly through NetTime and Gerd Loving. We met in person when for the first Berlin Biennale we did the hybrid workspace in Katrin David's Documenta, and you were invited by Katrin to be part of, I think, what was one of the very early moments when actually a large-scale Biennale Documenta exhibition type would actually invite digital art. And we discussed at the time the problematic, no, of how to bring this into an exhibition, and I remember very well you were very critical of the way Documenta did it. At the same time, I remember also that we discussed your reluctance about actually having a design or design a presence, which is then homogenizing. So I was kind of wondering if you can tell us a little bit about how to bring NetArt into exhibitions, and if your opinion changed or evolved since this conversation we had exactly 18 years ago in Kassel.
Yeah. Actually, now we just, in shows, we just want to show URLs, and without computers, like, everyone has devices to connect to the internet, so why not just print some URLs? And that's the way we like to see it, like, in a real space.
I think it's important, because by doing that, you also support the work to keep working on the web. Because don't try to like redo it in a local way, or if I mean, at least if the artist doesn't feel so, and we in general would not feel so, but so the address, the website name is the work. I mean, it's the key, it's the entry point to the medium, and by if you feel confident that that's a good work to show in an art show, then that's the perfect entrance. That's the point.
Like
you keep the
Kassel,
medium, you support
all
the medium, and
we are. Yeah, the works were just offline, and in a lot of museum setups, they have computers offline. I mean,
I mean, you've done some pieces though that aren't explicitly like web based, like the iPhone performances, and like other ways of getting out into the world.
Yeah, we focus on, because we started. Web work, and we still do, but in between we did game modifications and software and some objects and some video, but our I would say our interest or the way we what what I think is the most valuable, also the most interesting to work with, is just purely the web, just online, and sometimes it surprises me that it's not so recognized as a format. So people understand what a movie is, what a poem is, what a certain, you know, just and some a website, you know, there seems to be still a lot of
because it's everything
there's
at
still
once,
a lot of possibilities actually, because there's so many ways you can, you know, work website, make a website,
right.
And so I will,
but,
yeah,
but it's interesting that actually we are here in Basel, and Basel is also the city where one of your bigger exhibitions actually took place about 15 years ago. So I was kind of wondering if you can tell us a little bit about that, because you did bring your work into an exhibition context. It's also the context actually where a book of yours, a catalog, was published.
Catalog, yeah.
Small catalog, it's the only publication. Can you tell us about your story here with Basel and about this exhibition and how you brought it in the exhibition context there?
Actually, at the time, there was a media space called Plugin here in Basel, and it was just on the river. When we had to do an exhibition, we actually thought, "Oh shit, we need computers in a real environment." What we did is we took like this old ZX Spectrums from the 80s, and they didn't even exist anymore when I was a kid. So they were really ancient, and we found out that there were emulators at that time, and you could modify these games, and we could make versions out of a popular game called Jet Set Willy and completely strip it and make it empty and jump that Jet Set Willy could jump on Jet Set Willy again. And we presented this old TV monitors with old game consoles and old tapes, just to illustrate almost the difficulty of showing technology standards from nowadays in a white cube setup, so to say.
Yeah, I mean, we kind of walked around the problem by making a new work, which was not an online work, but it was a game work. But we exaggerated the hardware, the digital material side of a system to like the ZX Spectrums and so on. But in the show, there were also the websites, and I know that was displayed with a little platform. Like this, but with wires, because there was no wireless Wi-Fi routers at the time, so we were hanging
we
the Ethernet cables, and there were a set of laptops. I still know, in a box like that, you could get like four laptops and then plug into the wires hanging from the ceiling, and there was then a list of websites, like in the browser, for example, just the bookmarks, and that was our the platform for access to our websites in a very literal way.
And of course that leads us back also to Damon, because you use the medium of the exhibition very regularly. And most recently you did an exhibition where actually, of course, your program, which helps regurgitate actually pre-existing texts, what you explained, not with these misspelled, that led to books, and the books are presented in the exhibition. But you also presented actually exhibits on the wall. You used the white cube, so as to say, for your flower works. Can you tell us a little bit about the kind of how you bring the practice in the exhibition space, and maybe these most recent experiments with flowers, and that will then lead us directly to Jamie and to Brian.
Yeah, sure. I mean, so like when I show work, I don't necessarily think about it as like taking the things I've made online and putting them in the space. Like I have a pretty, I hope, diverse practice that like incorporates other things, photography, sculpture, so forth. So like to show is to an opportunity to like to do these other things. Those works in particular were outputs of programs, not web-based specifically, or some of them used web-based tools in their making. But you know, I think you would be able to like go through that show and not really like have like any sort of technological experience whatsoever, not really understand that layer of it, which is like what I kind of shoot for, maybe. It's, I don't want to be like characterized as somebody that like works with technology, because it's just such a part of everyday life and culture already. Yeah.
And can you tell us about the red roses for a blue lady?
The video?
Yeah.
That used a set of web-based tools that I built.
Is that used web elements and then you brought
them? Yeah.
The...
So like, I mean, I make almost like half of my practice is like just making tools, mm-hmm. and those tools tend to live online because I work online. And so I built a API for deconstructing text into phonemes, and then I built a separate web service that takes those phoneme streams and resynthesizes them, almost treating like speech as like a font. I glued all that stuff together and made a video where a performer sings red roses for a blue lady, but through this stripped down speech synthesizer that comes through all of these different layers. But so it's like the web isn't necessarily something that's like on exhibition, it's just like part of how I work, yeah.
Great, John, Dirk, and Damon, thank you so much, thank you. And please give now a very, very warm welcome to Jamian and to Brian. I just wanted to say before handing over that there are so many links between the two of you, not only that you very often visit each other's studios, collaborate, you founded a fashion line most recently called Charge the Charge Haircuts Hair, which will be launched later this summer in July at the Serpentine galleries in London in our pavilion of Bjarke Ingels. But you also, of course, both are connected profoundly through your thesis, both theses at Chelsea University, Brian's thesis, The Joy of File, which is about 21st century archiving between the digital and the analog, and of course, Jamian's thesis on the great Billy Grant and the many dimensions of Billy Grant's practice, you know, in his collective Raindrop, but also in his solo practice. It's almost like in superstring theory. There are so many aspects to Billy Grant and this idea also, what I thought was so fascinating about your thesis on Billy, in a way that through this generosity, and it connects deeply to what the three of you discussed, actually the work really infiltrates many different networks, and we can really say, you know, the Billy in you is the Billy in me. Please give a very, very warm welcome to Jamian and to Brian. And maybe we can begin with the same question I was asked Damon before, Jamian. What prompted you for this first ever panel, artist, to choose Brian, and how the two of you met and how you connect to his practice? What inspires you about it?
I thought it was the first person you asked couldn't be involved.
The first person I asked said no. No, I'm kidding. I'm joking. I'm just fucking around. But yeah, Brian maybe said yes. And then, it's funny. Brian, we're both from New Jersey. We both give each other a lot of shit. And, you know, he's one of my first friends when I came to New York. And kind of like, you know, he busts my balls, I bust his. And we kind of, you know, it's actually good criticism. And we also hang out a lot. I think even though our work looks totally different, we have a similar sense of humor and like mentality and just fucking with shit.
Right? Humor.
We should actually just show the videos first, or the photos. You know, the photos that would be helpful. So you can kind of see, I think we just...
Yeah, can we have the images? That would be good, if you may have the images.
All right, so this is...
That is me, and I have a tooth problem, which I'm going to have looked at after this lecture.
Yeah. We both have really terrible teeth, and it turns out we both have really good photos of our faces really fucked up. So those are Brian's, and then mine should come up next. They're really terrible.
You have the next image, please?
We like seeing who gets a puffier face, really. So usually when stuff like that happens, it's like whenever someone's stressed, it's like their face just blows the fuck up. And it's like it's always one of us. Someone has a tooth problem at all times. That was me before it got bad. And then the next one's insane. Yeah. So I went on a plane like that. Can't believe I'm showing that here. Oh my God, kill myself. But okay, you can take it down now, that's fine.
Are we human?
Yeah. But you know, it's like not only just the work and the way we talk, but kind of like personality stuff, you know? So
we'll get the rent together for Monday, I swear. So what about this chilling chant you were talking about? Billy Grant.
Oh, Billy Grant.
Yeah, Billy Grant, it's not, I mean, I mentioned the first time you ever told me about Billy Grant, he says Billy Grant.
Well, we're making...
And post-internet art, is there a...
Everyone's going to hate us after this. We're doing like a fashion line together, and Billy's kind of like the muse for it. Called George to George, hair cuts hair, and plugging it as much as I possibly can. And then Billy actually has a...
People are leaving.
I know. Billy actually has a solo show at MoMA in 2020, but Billy's work is really hard to categorize, and it's kind of performance and painting and video.
He's working on a program where he's taking classical music and converting it directly into perfume.
Sorry, we're just trying to fuck with you. It's fine. You can't keep a straight face and do this. Yeah.
And obviously, with Billy, you're doing this new fashion line, which is the collaboration between the two of you, George to George, hair cuts hair.
Yeah.
Can you tell us more about that?
I think that, you know, honestly, in terms of art, I think everyone's kind of just sick of the same shit. You know, it's like I make paintings, Brian does his work. We all, and you know, everyone looks at art all day long. At some point, you just want to stop talking about it and just do some shit that's interesting.
So and maybe like, even do the wrong thing.
Do the wrong thing, you know? So I think the important thing is like, I think the culture of living in New York and being an artist, you know, everything's like really professional and that kind of sucks, you know? So I don't know, why can't we just hang out and make stuff and then have that be part of our work? What's the problem with that? You know, like, it can be bad. Half of it's supposed
to be
bad.
Yeah, cut it off from ambition.
Yeah, yeah, fuck it. If it's not supposed to be good, you could do whatever you want, you know? So, like, who cares about good? Like, dumb or interesting or a punchline or something smart or something stupid.
Well, that's why also comedy is a great umbrella to get wet under.
Totally, because, you know, you can... You can get away with shit with that way that you can't get away with in any other arena. So it kind of gives you like a big comfort zone bubble. And also like as a collaborative, you know, it's like me, Brian, Billy Grant, and our friend Tyson Reeder. And you know, if it's a big stupid idea, everyone's responsible. So it's not, who cares if it's fucked up. If it's stupid, it's on everyone, not one person. So it gives you more wiggle room to like, do shit you wouldn't otherwise do.
Spread the blame.
Yeah, spread the blame, exactly.
And to connect it to the previous conversation, I wanted to ask you about, you know, digital, about the way you use also technology, because I remember the first time, Jamie, and we were introduced, it was Jens Hoffmann who actually, about a year and a half ago, said how urgent it was I visited your studio, and also that you, like me, would rarely sleep. So we had this 3 a.m. studio visit, and Jens mentioned that you would, you know, source images a lot from the internet and make kind of different collages. And of course, that's also true for Brian, because Brian, the first time I heard about your work was the way you kind of collage digitally the sound elements and music elements. So maybe it's interesting you talk a little bit about this idea of digital collaging and how you work with that.
Well, it's funny, it's like, you know, like, what you were saying, it's like, you don't want to talk about, it's not just about, like, the technology, or you don't want to be pigeonholed into some thing, you know, so people always talk to me about, like, my paintings as post-internet, and I'm always like, sorry, that just kind of fucked me up for a second, but post-internet.
Let's give another big applause to Annie Perlman.
Yeah.
Annie.
Yep. But, like, post-internet.
And to Billy Grant.
And to Billy Grant, yeah.
An applause for Billy.
Yeah. But like, you know, I...
Yeah, you were talking about post-internet, the question of...
Oh my God. Yeah. Insane. But for post-internet, it's like, oh my God, I keep on saying that word, shit.
Dadaism.
We always joke around, like we have a jar in Brian's studio, you know, that says like certain words you can't say and Dada's on there. Because he says it, like if you say Dada one more fucking time, you owe me so much money. But for the... whatever internet thing, that kind of work. I never think about that in terms of my work. I'm just thinking of the internet as a tool. And now, you know, for the next body of work I'm making, I'm trying not to use the internet as much because I feel like for me, in terms of painting, it's just using that as an entry point to get somewhere else. I don't really give a shit where it comes from. So now I'm trying to use most shit from books, you know, because there are things in images and printed matter that you won't find online.
She's getting into woodworking too.
Yeah, and I'm whittling stuff on the weekends now. But it's like a weird thing. And I think Brian and I, we get each other books a lot, you know, we give each other references and material. Like, he got me this amazing book for my birthday, like 2 years ago. You know, we give each other shit from New Jersey, Italian stuff. So he got me this Frank Sinatra book, Frank Sinatra's paintings.
Yeah, you showed it to me. Yeah, it's incredible.
It's incredible because, I mean, they're kind of shitty, but, and, you know, it's like some celebrity bullshit painting, but he visits modernism in like a really punctuated, quick way. So he'll do like a Kiefer, or he'll do like an A.R. Pank, or he'll do like a Clemente. Or, you know, he just visits these things really briefly and shittily, almost like a DJ. Or he's just like, you know, he visits them and then he moves on. But he just does covers of other kinds of painting.
I couldn't help but think that he went over and saw Miro at a friend's house and was like,
I'm gonna do it at home.
I could do that. That's no problem. Well, the funny thing about that book is I found out that it was one of Kippenberger's favorite books. And so I always just see that book on the table that he made of the Richter.
Yeah.
I could just see that, totally. You know.
And it's also funny because, like, you know, we always joke around about, like, you know, or like, you know, we, Brian always talks to me about me being like, like almost like a DJ, you know. It's like I'm taking all these different references and I kind of like spin them together and make a new playlist, you know. Which is like a really reductive way.
You should get into DJing.
Fuck yeah. You.
That's what great. Happens in the studio. I mean, visiting your studios, there are these books and you move books around, open pages, and then,
yeah.
You know, you show them and then they kind of enter the paintings. And obviously the same is true for Brian. You showed us all these children books.
Oh, he's
children
so
drawings. Because I think it would be interesting to hear about that. Your kind of, you know, investigation into children drawings, the San Francisco Children Drawing Museum, this archive.
Rhoda, what's her name?
Yes.
The woman that, Brian, every.
Oh, Rhoda Kellogg.
Here we go.
She's pretty incredible. She was a children's educator, art educator, and codified from scribbles on, like almost in a Jungian way, trying to cross-culturally bring together and codify children's drawings and development.
But ever since I've known Brian, you know, like it's funny. So we all came on the plane together, and I go in their room, Brian and Annie's room, and there's like stacks of CDs. He's like, I'm like, dude, we're going here for like 2 days. He brought like 45 fucking CDs, you know? And it's, that's just kind of how Brian is. So ever since I've known him, he's had this messenger bag full of children's book, like children's art books. And it's always like the same three. It's like, you know, almost like the icon of Brian. But it's funny. It's like, I think there's something about kind of just being curious and just fucking around that kids can do that we aren't capable of doing, you know, because we're so self-aware. And I think you have part of
are
that
we?
In you, you know, and that's why Brian and I are such good friends, because, you know, we help each other get there, because I don't know, I need that shit sometimes. I'm like too uptight, you know, but
we're definitely uptight.
And that's obviously the first book, because you mentioned as a accumulation and archive and lots of books and all kinds of other materials. That's the thesis, your thesis, and also your first book, The Joy of File. Can you tell us about that? Because that seems to be an obsession for archive, because your place is really jam-packed. It's full.
Yeah, I mean, sure. And, you know, the internet is also, I mean, we're all collectors. We're always collecting.
Like, you know,
it's endless.
Brian really. Has, like, you know, it's funny. It's like, what do you do? What, like, you know, he got, like, all these used tennis balls on eBay. It's like, why? He's like, I'm going to use them. I'm like, for what? You know, like hundreds of bells in his studio. And you actually saw all the bells, us with the bells, when you came over for the visit. And, you know, it's like he just is like an accumulator of things that are really specific. And it's like, you know, sometimes I'm like, this is like the last fucking thing I would ever buy online. Like a bunch of cowbells, you know, from like wherever. And it's like, I got new bells in the mail. I'm like, dude, what are you doing? But I don't know. It's like, that's a thing. It's like, I think it's like such a specificity that's unique to one person. It's not just like, I'm going to buy a bunch of these, like, you know, cartoon comic books from the 70s that are just like general bullshit. You know, it's like a very kind of like, I don't know. It's like an anomaly kind of thing. I think that's the thing we're interested in.
A problem.
It's a problem. Yeah. Yeah. Your bank account loves it.
But it's not all analog, because then you also have, you know, digital archives.
We love Instagram.
And Instagram, but also Snapchat. And then, Brian, in the late 90s, you learned this music software called Acid, which allows you to endlessly mix kind of and collage audio. And I thought it's kind of interesting if you tell us a little bit about that, because you you collect, of course, found photography, you collect books, but you also collect these found amateur sounds. And it's kind of like, almost a little bit like the Jim Shaw thrift store paintings, but for sound.
Oh, can you tell us about absolutely. That?
The singing in the rain one.
No, you know, for about 15 years now, I mean, well, actually longer, I was collecting found photography. But I didn't never realize that actually it amateur sound exists out there. Reel-to-reels, wire recordings, cassette tapes, people making recordings in their bedrooms during holidays, kids freaked out and hopped up on Coca-Cola, imitating, doing their best imitations of TV. Anyhow, I became obsessed with these things. Many of these documents, when I find them, I'm probably one of the first people to listen to these since the people who created them. So it's kind of like this archaeological thing, and you blow the dust off of it, and what you hear is just some kids spazzing out. So I started to collect this about 15 years ago and digitize it, and I've amassed a pretty large archive of this type of material. And I became acquainted with someone who goes by the name The Professor, who had a show on WFMU, which also highlighted this type of material. But it's funny because, you know, at this point, everybody's making this type of homegrown material in their bedroom. We're like kind of a culture of ham bones these days. People are very aware of the selfie and you know YouTube and on and on and on. But this earlier form, these things were just made for their relatives or their, you know, yeah.
You know, it was funny, like, I've been recording, well, you know, but I've been recording some conversations, like conversations with my mom on the phone, conversations with Brian, which, you know, he's pissed, but I don't know, I think it's important to, like, kind of catch shit off guard. And then just, you know, that's why I think it's probably coming from you, this influence, you know, and then editing it somehow. I know, I'm sorry too. But I don't know, it's like, you know, I don't know. It's like we hang out all the time, so there's always this crossover constantly, you know, especially like, you know, when you guys are talking about social media, I mean, we hate it, but we also use it a lot. I use it for research, you know, if you put in a hashtag for like stick bug porn, you know, you're going to get these, like, you know, stick bugs fucking on top of a car, but somehow it looks like an ARP sculpture or like a weird Calder or something, you know, and you would never get there any other way. And it's an image that doesn't exist in like Google Images or, you know, some stock photo bullshit. So I think, but also the way that we use Instagram, not only as research, but Brian posts things in threes typically, you know, so it'll be like all hand drawings.
On Instagram.
Yeah, on Instagram. But like, I think we both use it in like, try to be as productive as possible with it. I mean, it's also the internet. It's like, fucking who cares? Everyone uses it anyway. But I think to dismiss it as part of someone's like practice or whatever is impossible, you know? But I don't know. It's weird.
Brian, can you tell us about how you use social media? How you use Instagram?
I'm not working blue right now, am I? Oh, I use it. I turn the computer on and...
No, Brian's really good at shit talking on Instagram, but also, I mean, you know, go ahead. How do you use it?
Yeah, no, it's great. You guys should use it. It's called the internet. It's amazing.
He doesn't want to talk about it.
But you obviously also do you do performances because you mentioned the bells. So then these elements in the archive, you know.
We have the video.
And it's true, yeah, and it's kind of true for the digital archive because you kind of, out of this digital archive of music, you kind of developed the wordless chorus. It became a kind of a chorus, a performance. And then at the same time, you know, your analog kind of archive in the studio gets activated. I testimonied it when with Jamie visited your studio. Together with, you know, the great performer Billy Grant, you activated the bells. And of course, there is also your most famous performance, the burning video. Can you tell us a little bit about the performances? And I think it would be great for everybody to hear here the story of the burning video and, you know, having grown out of you being the class clown.
Well, when YouTube first came around, it kind of blew my mind. I thought it was amazing. I'm really into vaudeville and that sort of stuff. So I saw this as like a household vaudeville. And also from collecting all this amateur stuff, now people, amateurs were posting their amateurness. I was like a playground for me. So anyhow, I wanted to get involved and make the hit of YouTube. And so what I wound up doing was setting my hair on fire. I mean, who else wouldn't do that?
He actually did, and I think it doesn't even look like you're wearing pants in the video, and there's like a broken
pantless
window behind him. And he's literally, he just lights his hair on fire, and he stands there like this. And it's, then he's like, it's like burning for like a fucking minute, and he's just like standing there with this whole, like this whole thing is just like lit the fuck up. It's, but it's like kind of, that was like one of the first things I saw from Brian. I was like, I gotta be friends with this dude. This is insane, you know? But it's,
that's one of my mother's favorite performances. She's like, please never do that again.
Yeah. But I think something like that is just so extreme. It's like, you know, and he was doing it and no one was really even looking at the time, you know? So it's such an like an anomaly, weird decision to do. It's like something's wrong with you. But I don't know. Like Brian has many different bodies of work. He's been working as an artist for a really long time. So it's so insane. Like, you know, he does these performances and then he'll do these videos and then he'll make paintings and then he'll do sculptures and then he'll do the puff pieces. And I don't know. It's like actually how an artist should work, having like different ideas and you just do them in different ways. It's similar to the way Mike Kelly works, I think. It's like, however communicates this thing, fuck it, let's just do it that way. You know, instead of just having one thing, like I just make paintings, you know. Brian kind of does it all. So that's the thing that I, that's
badly.
Why, shut up. Negated, it's fine.
There's also, besides the burning video, there is a kind of a rumor that you loved hitting the floor. The kind of idea of falling on the floor. Can you tell us about that?
Really?
Yeah, no, that was an early obsession of mine, was falling on the floor. No, but actually, you know, after a while, I really started to study a lot of the slapstick comedians like Charlie Chaplin and Buster Keaton, Jackie Chan, all these kind of characters. But anyhow, I mean, I just love publicly going somewhere. Me and my friends would just go on a train and immediately just fall on the floor. And, you know, I find that it is alarming and gets people's attention.
We actually have a...
And then, of course, there is also painting. I mean, one of the things which connects you both is that you are both painters, and even, Jamie, and you always say you kind of hate painting, and yet you paint.
Yeah, we hate each other's
and
work, too.
Obviously, so. Also, Brian, you paint, and
isn't
I kind of like the
dead?
Idea that you once said that the idea of your paintings was to combine Agnes Martin and Liberace. Can you tell us about how that works?
It was a disaster.
That's amazing. Agnes Martin and Liberace.
Couldn't be two more opposite things. Well, a Zen master and a, you know, a glitterati.
Yeah. Or like, you know, Brian does these other, like, what was it? It was a Barbie version of what?
Frank Lloyd Wright.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's pretty amazing. But,
So, Jamie, what, because you obviously combine in your paintings.
Yeah.
Well, many different things. Can you tell us about how you combine, what you combine?
Usually, I mean, it just comes from either some kind of dream or just a general idea, and then I just make these lists of stuff, you know? So it'll be like like robot taking the SATs, or, you know, maybe like some kind of nightmare, like a St. Bernard and a hermit crab trap, and it's like, you know, so something that's like psychologically doing something. And then I have like three computers full of images, so either I'll like take a photo of something from a book on my cell phone, and I'll email it to myself, or, you know, I'm terrible at Photoshop, so if I need to figure something out, I could literally just tape the thing on the painting and just take a photo. It's like the most analog, backwards way to make something.
But it's also like a balancing game, a symbolic balancing game.
Back
because,
and forth.
Yeah, but it's like, what's the theatricality if I use this instead of this? Or
yes.
Should it be this? Or is that too dumb, or is that
exactly.
Not dumb enough, or
exactly.
Is that corny, or is
totally.
That campy, or that's, whatever the hell it is. Is that dark? Is that, you know?
Yeah.
So a lot of times we'll spend hours on the phone or with other friends, and you're really just trying to work out this balancing act, you know?
What is the right thing for this? It's like call and response kind of thing, you know? It's like you do one thing and then you respond, like, how do I make this transcend itself, you know? Or like, do doing, I also like the idea of making something that's difficult to get away with. So like,
or to be pigeonholed, of course.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, totally. I love being pigeonholed, totally. But that's, I think that's something that we always talk about. Like, what's pushing it just enough where we're like, what the fuck is this thing? You know? That's usually most of our conversations.
Yeah, no, confusing.
Confusing.
It's a good bar.
Yeah.
We always said this would be in three parts. There will be a very, very quick last part with questions to all of you, but that is end of part two. Thank you so, so much. Jamian, and thank you so, so much. Brian. Now, Jamian, when we started to kind of prepare this, the panel, kind of our previous conversation, we talked about your unrealized projects. And as you all might know, there is only one recurring question in all my panels and conversation, which is always for the ever-growing archive of unrealized projects to talk to artists about projects which have not happened yet, which were too big to be realized, you know, and there are all kinds of reasons why projects are unrealized, can also be censored, they can be self-censored. Doris Lessing said we should never forget the self-censored aspect, projects we didn't dare to do. Also projects which are too small to be realized. Sildo Meirelles, it took him many decades, he wanted to just have one building empty and a tiny little cube, so that project was too small to be realized, you know, forgotten projects. There's a whole range, a whole fan of the possibilities of the unbuilt. So I wanted to ask the five of you to tell us about one of your unrealized projects, which is particularly dear to you. And maybe we can start with Jamian, because we did have this conversation recently, and you mentioned, it was very Kippenbergering, you mentioned these high stools in the forest with stilts and something.
I wanted to basically do like the most powerful, tallest high chair possible, you know, so like a baby high chair. So I wanted to do like these 20-foot tall high chairs, and I wanted to put them in a cornfield so they kind of function like scarecrows, and then basically use that image as like if I could somehow figure out to get the whole thing illuminated by cop lights and just have that be like an installation somewhere, because you could do a birthday cake, you have police lights on it, and the whole thing becomes like a threat, you know, it's that simple. So either something like that, or also, I mean, jokingly, but not really, what if we took all the Manzoni, the cans of shit, and actually looked inside, like, is there anything inside there? Probably not, but that'd be something I'd like to do. And also, what we're doing, which may or may not happen with you in a month, so we'll see how terrible it is. Sorry in advance, yeah.
Brian, your unbuilt roads?
Well, we brushed on it before. Rhoda Kellogg, who is amazing, her foundation has probably about a million children's drawings and paintings. So I really wanted to put together a show of art educators across the globe of their collections. Because there's these, you know, if you think about kids' art, what's amazing is no one gives a damn about it. It's not worth anything. So, you know, it doesn't really get its day in court. So I would really love to put together a show which involves a lot of these hidden archives which are spread across the globe in some basement somewhere.
Or even all art dealers, usually were artists before, most of them made really bad shit. I think that'd be an awesome show, all art dealers, terrible drawings, their art before they became dealers. That'd be a good show.
Joan and Dirk, your unrealized project?
Yeah, there are loads of unfinished projects, but an unrealized project is actually, it started, I think, when I, to really visualize communication networks, but in the sense that if you have electricity going through a wall, you could imagine that everyone can see the wires going through these walls, but then you have like Wi-Fi around you now, and there's like basically all this noise going on, and we can only see it when it's kind of visualized in through a device. And I would just love to see it straight around, the whole fucking noise around you. That's a project I want to realize, but it's technically, I guess, a bit unrealistic. So, yeah.
Yeah, but I would support Joan, of course, as always. And no, I would make another website. That's, you know, not, yeah.
And Damon?
Well, for this one, I think it's feasible, but I haven't really figured out how to do it. For the longest time, I've wanted to get like a very large empty space, completely, completely dark, and light it only with incense as the only light source. Yeah. So somebody, let's make this happen. Yeah.
Let's make it happen. That could not be a more wonderful conclusion. Thank you so much to John, to Dirk, to Damon, to Jamie, and to Brian, and thank you all. And we also need to thank once more Annie, and in order to basically thank her, I have to say post-internet. Thank you all.